I think we stop it. Profitability ratio, right? Have we done the profitability ratio? Have we done this cost to income ratio? Or we yet to do?
We have to
Right. Okay. Profitability ratio is a other type of ratio, whereas we have already studied liquidity ratio, solvency ratio. Now we are looking into the profitability and asset quality. So these are the four ratios we need to look at it. So this is the third one. So what is profitability? Profitability for any organization is a key factor. The profitability ratio will reflect how well the management assessing its performance by utilizing the assets. So in banking, you have the assets are considered as loans. How well these loans are take the depositors' fund and loans are extended, and then the loans are well managed. When you are well managing the loans, you have the interest income, and bank also do the other services and levy a fee. So the fee income, interest income put together total income. So that is where the bank is earning income by utilizing its asset. So therefore, we are going to calculate how well the management has utilized its resources to yield a return. So remember, as far as if any investor considering to invest in a particular bank, they always look at profitability ratio. So there are few profitability ratio. One is cost to income ratio. It's very important. How much cost incur to earn a particular amount? Let's say if the cost to income ratio is 50%, meaning to earn 1 rupee, you are spending 50 cents. The cost to income ratio is 40%, to earn 1 rupee, you are spending 40 cents. So cost to income ratio is calculated operating costs divided by the operating income. So when you take the operating cost, it is the overall administration cost, employee salary. Sometime in the sum, they don't directly give you the operating cost. They will just say administration cost or employee salary. So you have to add these two to arrive operation cost, right? So remember that. Then operation and operation cost, you should not include the interest. You should not include the interest expenses, right? So let us look at it. Look at the cost income ratio further elaborated. Operating expenses. When you say operating expenses, it is totally operating, confined to operating. No financial cost should be included. Therefore, interest expenses should not come there. But look at the dividing factor, net interest income and other income. So when you say net interest income, you have to take the interest income minus interest expense. That is the net interest income plus other income. So that is how the cost income ratio worked out. So go back to the slide. So here you can see operating cost, which is generally administrative cost and employee cost and any other cost other than the financial cost, which is interest expense, should not come there. But when you arrive operating income, it is the net interest income plus other income. So that is what I have given the breakdown: net interest income plus other income. So if the ratio is 50%, it's considered very good. Anything less than 50, excellent. But more than 50, it's not bad, but the bank could still improve the cost to income ratio. But any bank reporting cost to income ratio as a 50% or less than 50%, it should be the identical situation. Right? You can hear me, right? You can hear me, right?
Yes, sir.
You can hear me, right?
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Yes, sir. Right. Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Okay, okay. So shall we work out cost to income ratio example? There is the number five. The following information been extracted from three leading banks in Africa: total operating income, total operating expense. It's very straightforward. So just put the ratio, which is cost to income ratio, is, you know, operating expenses or operating cost divided by the total income, that is net interest income and other income. But in this sum, they are given operating income and operating expense. So you need to take operating expenses divided by the operating income. There are three banks given. ABC, ABC, NC. Once you work out, tell me the figure. Anybody work on? How much the KBC bank?
50%.
ABC bank?
50%.
ABC?
66.67.
Okay. Okay. NCB?
46.67.
Fine. Good. So let us see the answers. What you have worked out is correct. Yes. You can see here, how do you work out operating cost divided by the operating income. So ABC 1000 divided by 2000, ABC 2000 divided by 3000, NCB 700 divided by 1500. The answers are 50, 66.67, 46.67. So when you look at these ratios, just tell me which bank is best. Which bank is best?
The NCB bank.
NCB bank. NCB bank. Yes. Why? Their cost is below 50. So the optimum level is 50. Anything below 50, excellent. So you can make a small note on this, saying cost to income ratio indicates how efficiently the bank is being run. Cost income ratio reflect or indicate how efficiently the bank is being 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 run. The lower the ratio, the more profitable the bank. And higher the ratio reflect somebody's mic is on. Okay. Let me say again, cost to income ratio reflect or indicates how efficiently the bank is being run. The lower the ratio, the more profitable the bank, and the higher the ratio reflects the inefficiency of the bank management. Inefficiency of the bank's management to inefficiency of the bank's management to keep the operating cost as low as possible. Either ratio reflect the inefficiency of the bank's management to keep the operating cost as low as possible. So you can comment on three banks. You can say ABC Bank has the highest ratio. Highest ratio of 66.67. Indicate low cost efficiency. It means low cost efficiency, comma, it means the cost are, comma, it means that costs are rising at a higher rate than income. At the higher rate than income. KBC maintain an optimum level of KBC. KBC Bank maintain the optimum level of 50%, which is considered as good as the average banking industry benchmark. Average banking industry benchmark. And this bank is managing their cost at a satisfactory level. then you can write the last bank. NCB Bank is the best performing bank. NCB Bank is the best performing bank out of all three banks. So remember, when you are given three banks, always you need to say, out of three banks, this is better. Or the lowest performing bank, then you can say, out of three, this bank is low. And when you are talking about the middle, you use the word moderate. So they are not either at a lower level or high level. They are in between. So you can use the word moderate level, right? So that is how you structure your answer. So you can say KBC Bank, sorry, NCB. NCB Bank is the best performing bank out of all three banks. Out of all three banks. As their cost income ratio, as their cost income ratio, 46.67. It's the best a bank could, the best ratio a bank could achieve. And further, it depicts DEPICTS apostrophe. Depicts. That depicts the efficiency, and it depicts the efficiency where the bank management, is running the business. Depict the efficiency where the bank management is running the business. Lower ratio is always better. Lower ratio is always better as bank could increase their profitability. Right? Okay. Let us look at here cost to income ratio. I have given 3 years, right? Then you need to, as I told you, cost income ratio is the operating cost, and when it comes to income, there are two combinations I have given: net interest income and other income. So here I have given interest earned, interest expenses, other income, operating. So the formula, you have to put it: operating expenses divided by, then you have interest earned minus interest expenses plus other income. That is how the formula. So shall we try the number 6? The expenses only, operating expenses. The interest in so I think I have given you here you can see net interest income and other income. How do net interest income is arrived? Interest income received minus interest expenses paid. So difference is net interest income plus other income. So therefore, we are trying to do a sum based on that. So you can put the formula and then write the figures. Remember, it is the same bank, but the figures are given for their last 3 year performance. So it's a one bank. Anybody get the answer, please let me know. What is the year 1, year 2, year 3?
For year 1?
Yes.
58.33%.
Okay. Second year? Second is on. Please remember, you do it on your own. We will discuss once you get the answer. So remember that. No point whatever answers shown here to take it down, because you need to work out on your own in the exam. So remember, these are not difficult, very simplified ratios. Get the proper answer, and you need to study how to explain in the exam. That is where the expectation. Know the ratios and interpret how the bank's performance, whether it's good or moderate or below the average. This is what you got to write, and you should know the ratios are increases. Certain ratios are increases, mean it's good. Certain ratios decreases are bad. Opposite also it could happen. When the ratio increases, it's bad. When the ratio decreases, it's good. So cost income ratio is something where the ratio is lower, is better. So, in second year answer?
53.57.
And the third year should be 40. Just see whether you got this answer. First year, 58.33. Second year, 53.57, third year, 48.48. So you can see 140 is the operating cost, 200 interest income, minus 120 interest expenses, plus other income. That is how the formula. So when you summarize, the answer is first year, 58.33, second year, 53.57, third year, 48.48. Everybody got the answer? Answer? Right? Oh, this is not very difficult. Remember, you need to know the ratio. Then, when the figures are given, put it in the right place, write the ratios and then start interpreting, right? So here, what is the trend? What is the trend you can see? Because this is the same bank. Same bank, 3A figure gives you the trend. Three different bank, you can make comparison. So that is a different. So you need to understand when the same bank's performance are given for 3 years, you look at the trend. But if three different competitors figures are given, you can always compare and then explain which bank is better compared to others. That is how you structure your answer. Always in exam point of view, they generally give two banks, not three, two banks, and ask you to compare which bank is better. So here, trend is, you can see 58, more than 50. Second year, they're improving. They're improving. 53. Third year, they've gone below 50. That means the bank is very well managing their cost. That is the bottom line, right? So you tell the examiner. You can say this bank's cost to income ratio. This bank's cost to income ratio is showing an excellent improvement. Showing an excellent improvement over the last 3 years. Over the last 3 years, the bank's cost to income ratio is showing a great improvement or an excellent improvement over the 3 year period or last 3 year period. Last 3 years. Over the last 3 years. It means the bank expenses. It means the bank's expenses are well managed. Are well managed. Or there could be two things. Either they would have managed their expenses or they would have increased their revenue. Or the bank would have increased their revenue. Increase their revenues. So in exam point of view, better to write the figures. So you can say, though the first year, cost income ratio was 58.33, and they manage very well in next 2 years and brought down the cost to 48.48 in the third year. So final, you can say this ratio could be compared with the other competitor banks, with other competitor banks? To gauge, G-U-A-G-E, to gauge their position in the banking industry, to gauge their position in the banking industry. Okay. I think I'll work cost income ratio. You know how to work out, right? Whatever figures come, remember, you don't sometimes get operating cost instant. You get some breakdown of different costs. They might say official expenses, or they might say administration cost, staff cost. So you add both together, arrive at operating. But you should not take the interest expenses, because financial expenses should not include in the operating cost. But in the operating income, you get the net interest income. Therefore, in order to get the net interest income minus interest expenses, right? And other income. Okay, let us see the other ratio under profitability. There's something called net interest margin. That is where we just did the, in the ratio itself, you minus the net interest and interest expenses, you minus, right? So we are here, second net interest margin that you call NIM, NIM. So what is your NIM mean? It's a net interest margin. So how do you derive this ratio? That means you generate, or the bank generate their income, interest income from their assets, right? That assets are, you know, all the loans and advance. So where you earn all your interest through that assets. So that is, you call average assets. So when you are divided average assets, where you earn interest, for which you need to pay depositors the interest, because you are taking the depositors' money to lend. Therefore, the net interest margin is the difference between the interest that you earn, the interest that you pay to the depositors, the difference divided by the average asset, and you arrive NIM. Generally, 3 to 4% considered, generally 3 to 4% considered is the average NIM, right? Average NIM. Okay, so let us see a sum, how to work out the NIM. Okay, so here the following information have been extracted from three leading banks in Europe. So it says interest income, interest expenses, assets. So it says calculate the net interest margin. So shall we start workout? So you know the ratio, right? You know the ratios. This is how the ratio should be. Net interest income minus interest expenses divided by average assets. Average assets. The sum is here. Exercise number 7. Once you get the answer, let me know. Always remember the either ratio is the better the performance. Either ratio is the better the performance. Anybody got the answer?
Sir, RBC is 2.5%.
Huh?
RBC is 2.5%.
2.5%. Who is the 2.5?
RBC.
RBC. Okay.
LBC is 3.48%.
Okay.
And SCB is 4.17%.
Right. I think the answers are seems correct. Here's the answer. 4.17 SCB. LBC 3.48. And RBC 2.5. So now tell me, out of these three banks, which bank has performed very well by using their assets, which is loans? Which bank?
LBC.
LBC? Why LBC? They are in between.
SCB.
SCB. SCB has a 4.17. I think they are the higher name. So now remember, don't think when you work out the ratio, when the ratio increases it's good. No, some ratios increases not good, decreases is good. Now the operating cost income ratio, you see, you saw it is lower the ratio the better the performance, because if you below 50 cost income ratio, that means the institution doing well. Institution doing well, but if the cost income ratio increases, that means they are unable to control their expenses. So, but here NIM, the higher the NIM is the better, because the average industry 3 to 4, but the SCB has done more than 4. That means better. So we can say NIM or net interest margin. Denotes, denotes, denotes the difference between just give a one line, always when you are writing answer, one line explanation of the ratio, then interpret the result. So you can say NIM denotes the difference between the interest income, and the interest expenses of interest paid, between the interest income and the interest expenses. By a bank, relation to its interest earning assets, relation to its interest earning assets, right? You can say SCB bank as the IS NIM of 4.17 is the best performing bank out of the three banks. So you can say SCB as the IS NIM of 4.17 is the best performing bank out of the three banks. It indicates this bank is well managing their assets, in order to maintain high NIM. It indicates the bank is managing their assets well, or the bank is well managing their asset in order to maintain high NIM. Followed by LBC bank, followed by LBC bank 3.48 also could be considered, as good, since it is within the industry average level, that is, which is 3 to 4%. They are also within that. Anybody between 3 to 4 is good. Anybody 4 above is excellent. That's what the SCB bank done very well. Then you can say the least bank. However, RBC bank could only achieve 2.5. RBC bank only achieved 2.5, which is below the average industry level. So this bank should, so always writes one sentence, the bank is not doing that great, how the bank should progress. So that also examiner might expecting you. So you can make just one sentence in every ratios. When you see one bank is not doing well, or in when you compare the same bank 3 years, whether it's the first year or third year, how the trend. Sometimes ratio must be given. First bank is very good. Second year, totally out. Again, third year, they average. So you need to write. And the worst scenario, which year? Or if there are three banks given, which bank is underperforming? Just add a sentence how the bank should come out from the problem, come out from the issue, right? So here you can say, what is the bank is the problem? We know the lowest bank is RBC. So you can say RBC below the industry. You know, you can say the bank should make necessary arrangement to manage their assets. This bank should make necessary arrangement to manage their assets more efficiently. More efficiently in order to be competitive, in order to be competitive among the other banks. In order to be competitive among the other banks. Okay. Now, remember, in exam, if you get a NIM of the same bank, right? Here, we did an example of three different banks. You can see RBC, LBC, SCB. Now, if the same bank, 1 year, 2 year, 3 year figures are given, remember the average assets. That means if you are given first year, and the second year assets, what you could do is, on the first year, you can take the asset as it is. But in the second year, add the first year asset, add the second year assets, put together, divided two. That is average. So remember, when it comes to average assets, meaning when there are two, if they in the exam, in the sum, if they give average asset, then you take it as it is. If they just say assets, but there are 2 years given, when you do the first year, pick up only the that asset. But when it comes to second year, it is average. So you have the first year, you have the second year, add and divided by the two, then it should become average. So make a note. In exam point of view, if the same banks 2 to 3 year performance are given and the assets are mention, then in the second year or including third year, you have to calculate average asset by adding first year and the second year divide by two. That is average, right? So let's see if you have some, when you're doing some sum, we will attend. Okay, so shall we work out the other ratio? Net interest margin done. Now ROE, what is ROE? Return on equity or return on equity. What is this? How much return banks gives against the capital put by the shareholder? That is return. What is return? Net profit. So net profit after tax divided by the total capital or equity into 100. So what is the percentage? That is what all the shareholders are interested in. So when they invest in any organization, they expect a return. So that return is considered as ROE. So remember, this ratio, investment point of view, is very, very crucial ratio. So you make a note. I think I would have given, to see in the ratio indicates how profitable a company or bank by comparing its net income to its average shareholder equity. The return on equity ratio measures how much shareholders earn for their investments. That is where the key investment. The higher the ratio percentage, the more efficient. So if the ratio is higher, it's the efficient performance, right? So always remember, when a particular ratio is high, whether it's good or bad. So you should know there are certain ratios, they are, when they are low, they are better, cost to income. Or maybe when we are looking at the asset ratio, non-performing loan, when you are having a non-performing lower loan, the better, right? So there are no go, don't go by that increasing trend is always better. No, that's wrong. That won't work. Okay, so you have to be a bit careful understanding each ratios, right? So what is return on equity or capital? You can also say ROC. Say ROC, that means return on capital. Or somebody might say ROI, return on investment. So all are same. Return on equity, return on capital, or return on investment. All are same. Right? So it is the net profit divided by the capital into 100. So shall we work out a sum? Here, the following information are extracted from three banks the end of 2019. Asia, Africa, America. All three banks. Net profits are given, capitals are given. Straightforward. Just work out. Calculate the return on equity or ROC or ROI. If you get the figure, let me know. How much is the Asia Bank?
11.67.
Right. Africa?
13.21.
Then the last, America?
15.6.
Yes. All answers 6. Correct. Here you can see the answers are. So, Asia Bank 11.67, Africa 13.21, America 15.6. So in looking at this, I think first you should, everybody should get the answers, right? Please do not copy, do on your own and then compare the answers, because in the exam you are going to do it. Right. Now, what are you going to explain? This is not the same bank to talk about the trend. Three different banks. Okay, which bank is done well? America is done well because they are returned. They are giving for their shareholder 15.6. So very good return, followed by Africa Bank. The Asia Bank is give a very moderate level of return. So remember, what is this return we are talking about? If you are an investor, if you have money, you have different choices whether to keep the money with the bank and confine only to the interest income. So say if you keep the fixed deposit for 1 year, you might get 4.5 maximum or 5. But you are the person wanted to earn more out of your investment. So you look for an opportunity. Where do I invest? Can I buy shares of a bank? So this is the ratio. Look at from the investor point of view. If I put my money as a capital to the bank, how much return the bank will give me? That is called return on equity. How much return they are paying me for my capital? So if anybody offer you 15.6, do you think who is going to give at this at the very best rate? But if you look at Sri Lankan context currently, the average about 11 to 14 is the returns. Most banks, some banks giving sometimes more than 15, but in the current last 2 years, it has been little slightly declined. Though bank make profits, but they are well, they're taking precautionary steps not to declare more dividend in the difficult times, right? So they give a moderate ROE, right? So just say, you can say ROE is a important ROE is an important component ROE is an important component in banking for measuring corporate performance, for measuring corporate performance. It is one of the key ratio from the prospective investors, from the prospective investor point of view, from the prospective investors point of view. It is one of the key ratio from the prospective investors point of view. So you can say America Bank has the highest ROE of 15.6, and it indicates the bank is effectively using the contribution of equity/capital, comma, investors to generate additional profits and return. Investors to generate additional profits. At an attractive level. Then you can say Africa Bank too is reported a moderate level of Africa Bank 2 is reported a moderate level of ROE of 13.21. However, the Asia Bank, is the lowest performing bank out of all three. By reporting a ROE of 11.67%. Asia Bank is the lowest performing bank out of all three banks by producing or by reporting a ROE of 11.67. It means the bank is not very efficient. In generating profit. Therefore, the bank should look at the possible avenues to increase the ROE. In order to keep the shareholders satisfied. Because it's a return on equity. So you need to keep the shareholder. The other people contribute equity, capital. Okay. Right. Now, I think in your notes, sometime you might not get this, but I have added because there's a one slide missed. That is return on equity one with there, but this might not be. Where are these ratios? Wait. I can share you later, right? You can take down return on assets. So we saw return on equity. There is something called return on asset that also you can work out. That is return on equity is you get more than 10% to 15%. But remember, you are comparing the bank's net profit against the total assets. So, which is generally, you can see the I have given, the world average is about 1.75 to 2. That is the average. So, if you have your net profit compared against the average asset. Remember, average. So, average asset means you know it's compared the bank's profit against the asset base, then the answer should be very low because you are comparing net profit against a large figure. It is not the capital, it is the entire assets. That's what you call return on assets. There are two things you learn. One is return on equity, other one is return on assets. Return on assets also worked out. In the exam point of view, sometime if you don't get the capital, if they are given asset, then you work out on the return on asset. Sometimes if they give both, that means they are given the net profit, they are given the capital, they are also given the asset. So with these three, you can work out both ratio. Net profit is there, that is important. If the assets are only given without the capital, then you work out return on asset. Sometimes if the returns and that means net profit and the capital is given, asset is not there, then you need not to work out. You work out only return on equity, right? So better to know that also. So here, there again, average assets. So if the 3 years are given, you have to take average, as I told you. So you make a note always, average asset mean always, if the assets for 3 years are given or 2 years are given, second year, you have to add it and divide by 2. Right, okay. So this is the indicator about 1.75. So shall we work out? Straightforward, instead of capital, you put average asset, right? So shall we see? ROEs we are done. Yeah, ROE, return on assets. Year 1, year 2, year 3. Now you need to be careful. Average assets, right? So what you do? First year net profit divided by assets, because there is no average, you can't take it, is only first year. But second year, you have to remember average, that means you have to take 15, again 15 and 15,500 and divide by 2. Third year, again take the second year figure and third year figure divide by 2. So just try profit 300 divided by, that means net profit divided by assets, average assets. So here assets are given. It doesn't say straight averages, it's assets. So you need to take averages. If the 3 years are given, you can take averages. This is only come when there are same bank 2 years. If the different banks are come, you need not to worry about average and all. You just simply take whatever given. So calculate return on assets. So now we are learning 4 ratios. First income, then NIM, then return on equity, return on asset. So sometimes you need not to do both return on asset and return on, if you do one, more than enough. But remember, first income, NIM, return on equity, these are very key. If the return on asset also given, try to do that. It is not that important, but ROE is the key. But ROA, still you can work out if the figures are available. So calculate the return on assets. So you need to, first year straightforward, second year 320 divided 15,000 plus 15,500 average divided by 2, get the figure. Third year 340 divided by 15,500 plus 16,500 divided 2 is average.
Sir, year 1 is 2%.
Year 1 is?
2%.
Right.
Year 2 is 2.10%.
Okay.
And year 3 is 2.13%.
Okay. Let's see if the answers are correct. Yes, correct. You can see 2%, 2.10, 2.13. So how do you work out? The first year, 300 divided by the assets, but the formula says average assets. So how do you, in the second year you work out, because you know first year end will be the beginning of the second year, right? So you have, you in the second year you have the first year closing asset will be the beginning, so you have two asset components, so you need to average it. So 15,000 and the second year 15,500 divided by 2. That's why I put plus and divided 2. third year, yes, second year closing will become opening. Then third year, you have to take the second year and the third year divide by 2. This is only you need to work out in this manner if the same bank's assets are given, where you need to work out average asset. But in the sum, if they say average asset and the years are given, you need not to worry about it because they say average asset. So they already work out. If they're given assets and 2 years are given, so remember in the second year, you have to average it, right? So the answers are, you know, what is the trend? The global trend is 1.7 to 2. So in all three banks are very good. The same bank, you can see the trend. So first year, 2. Second year, 2.8. So you obviously know, third year also they have done better. So what is the comment we are going to make? And you can say ROA, return on asset, helps. Help investors to measure how the bank management ROA helps investors to measure how bank management is using its assets or resources. Assets or resources to generate income. You can say the either ratio, the better it is. Then you can comment about the bank. So you can say the bank's ROA is showing a steady growth over the last 3 years. Ranging from 2% to 2.13. Which indicates this bank could produce relatively higher earnings in comparison to its asset base. This bank can produce relatively higher earnings in comparison to its asset base. Can produce relatively higher earning in comparison to its asset base. Further, this bank's performance could be compared. In relation to its peers. PERS. What is peers? Anybody? Relation to its peers. What is peers?
Competitors.
Yes. It's among the other banks. So remember these words, they might use it in the exam. So they might say peer bank. Peer banks mean other than this particular bank, all the banks are peers, competitors, relation to its peers, right? Okay. So now we are done the profitability. Now we are moving on to the last ratio. What is that last ratio? It's asset quality. Asset quality. What is asset quality? You know, asset is what all the loans are considered as asset in banks operation. Banks assets are mostly loans and advance. So asset quality means how best the loans that you are having as a loan portfolio, whether they are performing or non-performing. If the loans are performing, your asset quality is very high. You don't have any non-performing loans. So you know, we study non-performing overdue, then you have substandard, bad and doubtful, loss. These four categories. Where it's starting to overdue, more than 90 days. Any loan, whether the principal amount or interest is not paid for more than 90 days, it's become NPA. Then NPA will have a four category. These four categories are very much stringent, and the regulator says you have to shifting each category according to the timeline. If the overdue exceeds certain number of days where the capital interest is not paid by the borrower, you can't keep it as overdue. You have to shift to the next category, which is substandard. Then after a certain period, more than 1 year, up to 1.5 year, you put it into the bad and doubtful. More than 1.5 year, you read to write off. That means loss. So four categories we study. So remember that. That is called classification of loans and advance. So here we are going to, based on that, we are going to look at the assets quality. What is asset quality? The bank's loans, whether they are performing loans. If the performing loans are there, the assets quality is high. So let us look at it. Non-performing loans, NPE, NPL or NPA. It can be non-performing loans or non-performing advances, NPA or NPL, NPL. Loan on which borrower is not making interest payment or repaying any principal. What do you mean by principal? It's the loan amount. When you borrow a loan, say 100,000 you borrow, you need to repay the loan. That repayment is called principal amount. On top of that, you need to pay interest. So when you borrow a loan from a bank, there are two things. You need to repay the loan, which is the principal amount, and you need to pay interest. Both put together, that is your monthly repayment. So when you monthly repay, it consists of part of principal and the relevant interest component to the loan. Both added comes as repayment. So when you don't pay the repayment, you are not paying interest, you are not paying the repaying the principal amount. That is where the problem is, right? So when the NPA happens, what will eventually, you can see what is happening when bank take depositors money and give it to somebody, that somebody is not paying the loan. So what will happen? The bank net interest income going to affect. Why? The interest income is not coming. So their profitability going to come down. Not only that, after 1.5 year, if the loan remains same, you need to absorb the entire capital, the 100,000, whatever you are given the loan. You can't keep the loan outstanding in your book. You have to write off. How do you write off? From your shareholder funds. You can't write off from the depositors' fund. You have to absorb it. That is where when NPAs are coming, banks are very much alert, because it is going to impact their profitability, liquidity, and their shareholders' funds. So all three are going to impact. Always remember, NPA is impacting profitability, liquidity. Why liquidity? Because when you take the depositors' money and giving it to somebody as a loan, that somebody has to repay. Then only you can repay to the depositors. Now what happened? You have taken a depositor, you are paying interest to the depositor, but that particular funds, deposits funds, as given as a loan, that particular borrower is not paying the interest. So you are going to continue to pay the interest to the depositor. So then what will happen? Bank income will get affected. Why? Interest income is not coming, but interest expenses remain there. So eventually your profitability will be affected. One fine day, if the borrower unable to repay the loan after 1.5 years, it is lost. So what will happen? It's going to impact the profitability and it's going to impact the shareholders' funds. And when you don't get the money, you're short of liquidity. So remember, NPA has impact of all three: profitability, liquidity, and the shareholders' funds, right? So you have to be very careful. That is what you do provisions. What is mean by provision? When you know first year, there are certain amount of loans which these particular borrowers are not paying. How do you know they are not paying? Because those loans are gone into overdue. 90 days, more than 3 months, they are not paid. Now you classify them overdue. Then you know in this particular year, if they don't pay in the next year, what will happen? If you don't provide provision, next year you will have a huge amount write off. So what is bank does every year when they have a gross NPA, they do provision. That means from their profit, they take certain amount and putting into the provision account and keep it. And by doing that, they are showing additional expenses in the P&L and keep a certain amount set aside. That is called provisions. So bank do the provision in order to absorb unexpected losses, right? Totally unexpected. Next year, the particular company is closed down. But you presume next year we will try to recover. You didn't provide the provision this year. What will happen? Next year, the entire loan you have to absorb. But in the current year, if you have done provision about 50%, then you know next year you are going to absorb other 50%. But if you don't provide the 50% the current year, anticipating next year, the entire 100% can be recovered. But unfortunately, if you're unable to recover, next year, the entire 100% going out of your P&L. So that's going to impact your profitability. That is what all the banks, when they have NPA, they always provide sufficient provision. That is the best way. That is the more prudent way to do provision. Never mind you over provide, because next year, if you recover the loan, the additional provision can be treated as a income. Because you, whatever the amount you currently you keeping aside, thinking this could be utilized next year if the loans need to be write off, right? But next year you manage to recover the loan, then it is coming back again to the P&L as income, because you did more provision previous year. Therefore, always maximum provision. Generally, the industry level is 70%. 70% if you do the provision of your NPA loan, the best, right? So shall we try to work out how the formulas are? Yeah. Non-performing loans advances divided by, always remember, gross loan. Out of your total loan, how much? The NPA. How much? Your NPA into 100. That is gross. Gross mean from your total loan, so much is bad loan. Then there's something called net. Net mean you have an NPA, then you have done provision. So you minus the provision. Again, divide by gross loan. So there are two ratios, gross and net, right? So this is where the NPS are worked out, right? So shall we see whether we can try this sum? Yes, number 10. Calculate the non-performing loans. Here provisions are not given, so you presume it's a gross. Net mean the provision should have been there. So work out the non-performing loan. That means NPA divided by total loans. If you work out, let me know the answers. How much the debt?
Four percent.
That is 4%. Okay. Tom?
3.13%.
3.12. Okay.
Hot?
6.5%. 6.5%. Let's see whether this answer, yes. Yeah, you can see the answers are correct. Dot 4, com 3.13, cot 6.5. So when the NPA ratios are lower, it's better. So that's what I told you. Cost to income, NPA, lower the ratio is better the performance. Other ratios, generally higher the ratio is better the performance. Capital adequacy, liquidity, right? Return on assets, return on equity, but cost this particular. Can you hear me? You can hear me, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. So let us say some simple notes on NPA. NPA. It's a loan. NPA is a loan in which NPA, the law in which the borrower is in default, default, in which the borrower is in default and has not paid NPA is a loan in which the borrower is in default and has not paid the monthly principal within bracket you can say loan amount principal is the loan amount within bracket loan amount monthly principal within bracket loan amount and interest payment for a specific period. So you can say the lower the ratio the better the performance of the bank. Lower the ratio, better the performance of the bank. So you can say out of three bank, you can say Tom Bank has the lowest NPA of 3.13%. Which reflects the bank is well administrating their loan. Well administrating their loan portfolios. Portfolio means there are number of loans. All the loans you call loan portfolios. Administrating their loan portfolio and recovering such loans. In an efficient manner. Then you can say Dot Bank as a moderate NPA of 4%. Dot Bank as a moderate NPA of 4%, which is well within the accepted industry range. Generally we say 3 to 4, no? That's the range. Then you can say the last bank. Hot Bank. As the highest NPA of 6.5%. Which reduces the interest revenue. Investment openings. Now see, the bad loans are a lot of issues. So it reduces the interest revenue. Not only that, investment openings and further reduces the capacity of bank. Further reduces the capacity of the bank to sanction. That means to approve new loans. Because what happen here, when the NPAs are increasing, all your monies are blocked. So you are unable to invest. Investments are closed because you can't look at any new investment because all your monies are blocked with NPA. So when you are having a high NPA, what happen? It reduces your revenue and investment openings mean there are other opportunity. You can invest, but you don't have money because all these loans are taking care of your investment because those loans are become bad. So you have stuck with new capital to invest. Okay. So that is what you say, reduces the interest revenue, investment opening, and further reduces the capacity of bank to sanction new loans. Then you can say continuation of increased NPA. Continuation of increased NPA may lead to liquidity crisis. Liquidity crisis. And even failure of bank. So remember, the NPA is a dangerous factor in banking. If you're unable to manage your NPA, it's going to affect everything. You don't have money because all your depositors' monies are given loan. Those loans are non-performing. All the capital are blocked. Your assets are not quality because it loses the quality because all these loans are not performing. When non-performing loans are there, you don't have new liquidity. The money that have been given, you are unable to recover. So you are short of liquidity. And your revenue also getting affected. Why? Interest income are not reporting. Right? Not only that, after a certain period, you need to write off the loans. That is going to impact the shareholders' funds. And remember, if your NPAs are increases, if the new investors who want to invest in the bank, they will never think of coming because they know this bank is into problem. Why? They are going to take the investors' money to set off the bad loan. So investors might think. So remember, in the bank, if somebody wants to invest in banking sector, they are very much key to look into few important ratios. One is return on equity, cost to income ratio. Then NPA. NPA is the killing. Because NPA going to impact their investment. Because if the bank has a higher NPA, end of the particular period, bank need to absorb. How do they have that? They absorb it from the shareholders' fund, which is going to impact the investors. So that is what they are very keen, right? So you can see liquidity crisis. So they might end up with failure. Okay. So shall we try to do it the other sum also? calculate the non-performing loan ratio. Ah, net. Okay. So you do. What do you do? Net. What do you do? So here, yeah, let me see. How do I answer? Net. Net mean non-performing advances minus provisions. Same formula. Divide by gross loan. So shall we try number 12? Sorry, number 11. By the way, there is an announcement. I have been asked to keep you everybody informed. There's something called you have classroom, right? Some facility to give. In that, there is an evaluation form. So these people have, the IBSL told me to keep all you informed. In the classroom, there is an evaluation form. You need to fill it and send it to them. So not immediately, but they have said to do it. So take your time. Once the class, when you find time, log into that, give your evaluation, right? That's just an announcement. Okay, so let's try this number 11 exercise. Calculate the NPA net. What do you do? You put the NPA minus provision divided by total loan.
Sir, Gold Bank is 2.5%.
Which bank?
Gold Bank.
Okay.
Silver Bank is 3% and Bronze Bank is 2.6%.
Ah, okay. So let's see. Everybody try to work out. So you will see the answer seems correct. So how do you work out? So try to do on your own. Right, I'll give you one more minute. So you can see, you take NPA minus the provision divided by total loan. So the Gold Bank has 2.5, Silver as 3, Bronze as 2.6. So whether everybody getting this answer. Here is the answer. So you minus 100 divide by the provision 25 into divide by gross loan into 100. So you can get 2.5, 3, 2.6. Which bank is better? Out of three, which is the best? Which is the best? Gold Bank. Gold Bank has the lowest net NPA, right? Followed by Bronze. And the Silver, slightly higher NPA of 3. But they are not very bad. All banks are same good result. So you can, once you have the answer, shall you write down and say net NPA. Net NPA is the amount. Net NPA is the amount obtained. Net NPA is the amount obtained on deducting provisions. On deducting provisions from gross non-performing loans, gross non-performing loans. Non-performing loans or non-performing advances, NPL or NPA. can say Gold Bank as the lowest. Gold Bank as the lowest net NPA of 2.5. Gold Bank as the lowest net NPA of 2.5 and followed by Bronze with 2.6. Followed by Bronze Bank, 2.6, which indicates both banks are well managing their loan portfolio. Well managing their loan portfolios. And reporting very low NPA. Both banks are well managing their loan portfolios and reporting very lower NPA. However, Silver Bank has a slightly higher NPA of, however, Silver Bank has a slightly higher NPA of 3%. But still, this ratio well within the, but still the ratio is well within the range of industry level. Okay, now we are moving on to the last ratio under asset quality, which is very simple, provision coverage ratio. So we will work out that is what is provision coverage. Yeah, provision coverage. You call it PCR. Right, PCR, you know now what is PCR, huh? That is test also now PCR, no? Okay, this is PCR is provision coverage ratio. That means how much provision you are setting aside against your NPA. So it's very simply, you do the provision divide by NPA in 200. So even the last sum you did, you can work out the PCR. Why? Provision is there, NPA is there in 200. That's the PCR. How much provision you do against your NPA? Simple as that. It's very simple. Higher ratio always better because you do more provision against your NPA. Right? Okay. So let's see whether you can do a sum, work out the PCR. So what is the ratio? Provision divided by NPA. Straightforward. Calculate the PCR.
The Gold Bank is 60%.
If you work out, you can tell me the answers.
The Gold Bank is 60%.
Gold Bank is
60%.
60%.
Yeah.
Okay.
Silver Bank is 44.4%.
Silver Bank is
44.4%.
Okay.
Bronze Bank is 50%.
Bronze Bank is 50%. So shall we see the answers? Yes. Gold Bank is 60%. Silver Bank is 44.44, and the bronze is 50. So out of three, tell me which bank is prudent, which bank done the right thing.
Gold bank,
because they have provided 60 provision against 100, so that means their provisions are more. Look at the Silver Bank, against 180 loan, they only provide 80. So they are 44. The other bank, they are moderate, just 50%, right? So you can say PCR indicates the extent of funds. PCR indicates the extent of funds. Extent, extent, extent of funds. A bank has kept aside to cover loan losses. PCR indicates the extent of funds. A bank has kept aside to cover loan losses. IPCR can be beneficial to bank. To guard themselves against losses. Guard themselves against losses if the NPA start increasing faster. Let's say IPCR can be more beneficial to banks to save or to guard themselves against losses if the NPA start increasing faster. So you can say the Gold Bank has the highest PCR of 60%, which indicates that they are taken prudent. Prudent is the right step, correct step. Taken prudent, P-R-U-D-E-N-T. Taken prudent decision to provide more provisions. So, which indicates that they have taken prudent decision to provide more provisions. Though they are below the industry average level of 70%. Though they are below the industry average level of 70%. Because what happened? You can't say 70% and apply to all the banks in globally, because different economy will have a different impact. But generally they say average 70%. So it might not work for all the countries. because the countries have a different economy. So you can't set a one calculation ratio and say it should be applied right round. No, it won't apply. It won't apply because there are certain industry. But if you take banking industry, still they are functioning in different economic level. So each country will have their different economics level. So there are poor countries, the NPA must be very high. Their average provision may be 50% is more than enough. But there are certain countries, they are very, central bank is very stringent. They say you must have 70%. So it depends. Now this example, you get 60% means sometimes is very good. But though we say the industry level is 70%, but still the bank has done a prudent thing, right? Okay. Then you can say bronze bank has 50% PCR. Bank has 50% PCR, and followed by silver bank, followed by silver bank only with 44.44. You can say, comma, these two banks should take appropriate decision. Appropriate decision to increase the rate of provisions. Increase the rate of provisions as it is good for the banks. As it is good for the banks to go for higher PCR. As it is good for the banks to go for higher PCR when they are making good profits. When they are making good profit. Sometimes, remember, so first you write down, as it's good for the bank to go for higher PCR when they are making good profits. So what I'm trying to say is, when there are certain banks, they report good profit, but to see they have not provide sufficient provision coverage. They are marginally done. Try to show their profit have been increased comparison to the last year. I think a prudent decision should have been, you show the moderate level of net profit growth doing the maximum provisions. It's always prudent and better. So the good bank or the bank that have been administrated by good governance, what they will do, they always ensure maximum provision is the best solution. Because no point showing a higher profit and next year you fall far below the average. Why? You didn't do the provision, and the next year lot of loan become bad, or maybe the change of some external factor affecting you, a huge losses of loans. But if you guard the bank themselves by providing sufficient provisions against these unexpected loans, then you will not have the shocks. Otherwise, you will have a huge disappointment. The bank shareholders might shouting at the bank management, but what happened? Why we all of a sudden reported an increased profit in the previous year? All of a sudden, we have fallen nowhere. So that is not the correct trend. So you have to be careful. The banks has to be careful. Okay. So this is what all the ratios that we discuss are important in the exam point of view. But I have taken other three more issues. One is credit to deposit ratio, which is more relevant to the bank. Other two are not relevant to the bank. That means debt to equity ratio, debt to asset ratio. That means when an organization do the businesses, they compare their outside loans against their capital, or they compare their loan against their total assets. That is what you call debt to equity or debt to assets. These two last two ratios are not for the banks, because the banks operate differently. Because bank take debt, mean the all these deposits are considered as loans to the bank, so they are appearing in the liability side. So you can't have debt to equity ratio, because bank has borrowed more from the deposit, so it won't applicable to the banking. But the first one only applicable to the bank, credit to deposit. That means how much loan you are granting against your deposit, right? So we will, next class we will work out example of these three ratios and attempting past papers. Okay, so I will see you in the next class then. Okay.